So let's start with the first topic of our MCQ revision series, that is general pharmacology. Now we will discuss general pharmacology in various steps. The first step will be pharmacokinetics, that is the movement of the drug inside the body. Then we will discuss pharmacodynamics. Pharmacodynamics is the effect produced by the drug. Then we will be discussing about the drugs, that how drugs are made, known as drug development, and various miscellaneous topics related to drugs. Okay, so these are the concepts. This is how we will be dividing our general pharmacology, pharmacokinetic, pharmacodynamic, and the various aspects of the drug. So let's start with the pharmacokinetic, a very rapid revision series. So the first part is pharmacokinetic. Now remember, pharmacokinetic is the pharma means drug, kinetic means movement. It is the movement of the drug inside the body. So when you give the drug, first of all the drug will get absorbed into the systemic circulation. Okay, it will come into the vena cava circulation, known as absorption. Then when it comes into the blood and it will get absorbed, now it will be distributed into the whole body, known as distribution. Now the body will try to eliminate this drug out of the body, and the body will try to convert this lipid soluble drug into water soluble. This is known as metabolism. And after that, the drug will be eliminated out of the body through various body secretions, known as elimination. So we will be discussing this pharmacokinetics into four parts, that is absorption, distribution, metabolism, and elimination. So let's start with the absorption. Now the first question is asking that which of the following process is best suited for permeation of a drug from a very large molecules into the cell. Now remember, how a drug crosses a cell membrane. Remember, the most common method of crossing a cell membrane is passive diffusion. Okay, so the most common method of crossing a cell membrane is passive diffusion. Passive diffusion means along the concentration gradient, it will come into the blood, and it is seen by lipid soluble drugs. Okay, now what are the other methods? Other method is active transport. Active transport, we can write an example which drug gets absorbed by active transport. We can write alpha methyl dopa and levodopa. Then you can write facilitated diffusion. Now facilitated diffusion, you can write an example 5-fluorouracil and sodium with glucose, which is present in our ORS also. And remember, last point is pinocytosis. Pinocytosis, also known as endocytosis, which is known as cell drinking, is shown by large proteins. It is shown by large proteins. So the answer for this question is B, endocytosis. Now let's come to the next question. Which of the following term describes the process by which the amount of a drug in the body is reduced after administration but before entering into the systemic circulation? So suppose you have given a drug orally. The drug will cross certain barriers. The first barrier is mucosal cell barrier. Then it will come into the portal vein blood and it will go to the liver. And from liver, it will come into inferior vena cava and reach to the heart. Now, when the drug reaches into inferior vena cava, it is known as systemic circulation. So before that, a drug has to cross certain barriers like mucosal barrier and liver. Together, this mucosal barrier and liver is known as first pass effect. Together, this mucosal barrier of the GIT cells and liver is known as first pass effect. So before a drug can reach into the systemic circulation or caval circulation, the drug gets reduced by the first pass effect. Now let's come to the third question. Which of the following drug has maximum chance of absorption from gastric mucosa? Now remember, from gastric mucosa, we know that in stomach, we have HCl. In stomach, we have HCl. That means there is a presence of acid. Now remember, acidic drugs gets more absorbed from stomach, because acidic drug in an acidic media becomes as a lipid soluble, and among them, this phenytoin sodium is an acidic drug. Okay, so phenytoin or all anti-epileptic drugs are acidic drug. Okay, so let's write the list of certain acidic drugs. You can write all NSAIDs are acidic drug. All anti-epileptic drugs are acidic drug, including phenytoin. You'll write barbiturates are also acidic drug. We'll write alcohol. and you will write warfarin. So try to remember only these drugs. These drugs are acidic drug, and acidic drug gets absorbed from stomach, while morphine, amphetamine and quinine, they are basic drug, and basic drug they get predominantly absorbed from intestine. Now let's come to the fourth question. A highly ionized drug is, remember, if a drug is highly ionized, ionized means water soluble, and if a drug is highly water soluble, can we say it will be easily excreted out in urine by the kidney? So the answer for question number 4 is A. If a drug is water soluble, it will be easily excreted out into the kidney. Now the point is, if a drug is water soluble, it will not love to cross the cell membrane of a cell. If a drug is ionic or water soluble, it will not easily cross a cell membrane, because the cell membrane is made up of lipids, and only a lipid soluble drug can cross. Now can we say that placental barrier is also made up of cells, syncytiotrophoblast and cytotrophoblast? Can we say intestinal cells are also having lipid bilayer, and the drug will not be accumulated in cellular lipid, it will cross outwards? Hence remember, here only and only non-ionized or lipid soluble drug will show this property, while ionized drug will be easily excreted out through kidney. So let's come to question number 5. The extent to which the ionization of a drug takes place is dependent upon pK value of a drug and the pH of solution. Which of the drug is dissolved? Now, which of the following is incorrect statement among them? So the question is asking, which of the following is incorrect statement? Now, what is pKa? Remember, pKa, suppose if you put a drug into a media with having a specific pH, and if in this media, if a drug becomes 50% ionized plus 50% non-ionized, if in a particular media drug becomes 50% ionized and 50% non-ionized, then this pH becomes the pKa value of a drug. Okay, this pH becomes pKa value of the drug. So the first statement is true. Okay, the first statement is true. Okay, so this is, but we have to find the false statement. Small changes pH near the pKa value of a weakly acidic drug will not affect its degree of ionization. Now remember, if you will put an acidic drug, let's say we call that acidic drug as pKa, and if you put a basic drug, let's call it as pKb. Now remember, if you put an acidic drug in an acidic media, it will become more of a lipid soluble. And if you put a acidic drug in a basic media, it will become water soluble. Similarly, if you put a basic drug in a basic media, similar media, it will become lipid soluble. And if you put an basic drug in an opposite media, it will become more of a water soluble. So remember, water soluble drugs are known as ionized drug, and lipid soluble drugs are known as non-ionized. Hence, if you will change the pH, remember, the ionization potential of a drug differentiate. So it will affect the degree of ionization. Hence, this statement is false. So the answer for the question number 5 is false. So if there is a small change in the pH near the pKa value of a weakly acidic drug, will not affect its ionization? No, it rather affects its ionization. Okay. Now, knowledge of a pKa value of a drug is useful in predicting its behavior in various body fluids. The answer is yes, because every fluid like blood, urine has a particular pH. And phenobarbital with a pKa value of 7.2 is largely unionized in at acidic pH, will be about non-ionized in plasma. Now the point is, as we know that phenobarbital is having pKa value of 7.2. 7.2 is more of a neutral part. Okay. Now the point is, this pKa phenobarbital itself is an acidic drug as compared to blood, because a blood has a pH value of 7.4. So if you put an acidic drug in a more acidic pH, it will remain more of a non-ionized. Hence the statement is true. So the answer is B. So let's come to question number 6 now. All of the following statements regarding bioavailability of a drug are true except. Okay. So the answer for this question number 6 is, it is a fraction of administered drug that reaches systemic circulation in unchanged form. The answer is true. This is the definition of bioavailability. Bioavailability of an orally administered drug can be calculated by comparing area under curve of oral and intravenous. The answer is yes. This is the formula of bioavailability. This is the definition. This is the definition. This is the formula. Now, low bioavailability always and necessary means poor absorption. The answer is false. Okay, so this is the false statement. I'll tell you the reason why. Now let's come to bioavailability can be determined from plasma concentration or urinary excretion data. The answer is yes, true. Okay, now remember oral bioavailability. If you talk about oral bioavailability, we have already discussed that when a drug comes into the GIT, first it gets crosses the mucosal barrier, which is known as absorption. Then it comes into the portal vein, it goes into the liver, and liver degrades the drug. This is known as first pass metabolism of liver. First pass metabolism. So remember, bioavailability depends upon absorption of a drug as well as first pass metabolism of a drug. It does not mean it will always have a poor absorption. Okay, so it is just not, does not depend upon the absorption, it will also depend upon the first pass metabolism. So let's come to the question number 7. Drug transport mechanism includes, the answer for this question number is active transport and passive transport. These are the two mechanism, and we have already discussed about discussed about a mechanism known as pinocytosis, and we have already discussed about the mechanism facilitated diffusion in the question number first. So these are the various methods by which a drug gets transported. Let's come to question number 8. Causes for reduced bioavailability include, we know that the final amount of the drug that will come now into the blood is known as BA. BA means bioavailability. So can we say if a drug has lower absorption or high first pass metabolism will have poor bioavailability? So the answer for this question number 8 is high first pass metabolism in the liver. Okay, now remember, if a drug has high first pass metabolism in liver, liver will not allow this drug to come into the blood. Hence, the bioavailability of a drug will reduce. Increase absorption? No. Increase in absorption will increase bioavailability. High lipid solubility will increase absorption and it will increase bioavailability. And non-ionization means highly lipid soluble drug. So this is the true answer, the first one. So let's come to question number 9. The ninth question is asking, high hepatic extraction ratio is seen in all of the fall, is seen in all except. Okay, so the answer for this question number, the answer for this question number 9 is ampicillin. Okay, so let's see what are the drugs which have very high hepatic extraction ratio or high first pass metabolism in liver. So we will write the drugs are HILT, that is hydrocortisone, isoprenaline, lignocaine, and theophylline. Okay, that is why these drugs are not given orally. But there are certain drugs which are given orally, but in a very high oral dose. The drugs are, you can write a mnemonic, PM, VP, SYNC. So propranolol, morphine, verapamil, pethidine, salbutamol, imipramine, nitrates, guanethidine. Okay, guanethidine, H you can make it with this only, high first pass metabolism. So these are the examples of the drugs with very high first pass metabolism. So for the complete concept of high first pass metabolism, you just share the videos. Okay, just go through the video lectures. Okay, high first pass metabolism. So if a drug is having high first pass metabolism, some drugs are not given orally, while some drugs are given orally but in a very high oral dose. Okay, so these are the examples. So let's come to question number 10 now. Now question number 10 is asking, which of the following drug does not undergo high first pass metabolism? So we have already discussed all these drugs. So in this option, insulin we have not written. Okay, So all these drugs we have already written in our above mnemonic. Time for peak plasma concentration Tmax indicate. It indicates rate of absorption. Now remember, when we give a drug to our patient, suppose you have given a drug to your patient, we will draw that after how much time it will come into the blood. Okay, so we will draw the plasma concentration with time graph. So when you give a drug, the drug will come gradually into the blood and it will reduce in the concentration of the drug will reduce in the blood. So this graph is known as concentration time graph. Okay, now suppose this is the drug A and this is the drug B. This is the drug B. Now can we say that this is the maximum amount of the drug which comes into the blood? Okay, and this is the time at which it will come into the blood, Tmax. We call this time as Tmax. So this is the Tmax of A and this is the Tmax of B. Okay, now can we say that A drug, that Amax of Tmax of A is less than Tmax of B? Okay, so can we say that Tmax is coming rapidly into the blood as compared to B? So A comes rapidly or it has a very fast absorption into the blood, while B has a very slow absorption into the blood. Hence, this Tmax tells us about the rate of absorption. This Tmax tells us about the rate of absorption. Okay, so remember this part. Now let's come to the 12th question. High hepatic first pass metabolism is seen in all of the following. We have already discussed the answer, cimetidine. So we have already written the mnemonic. We have written all these drugs have a very high first pass metabolism in liver. Now, which of the following drug has least oral bioavailability? The answer is D-tubocurare, because D-tubocurare is highly ionic drug. It is highly water soluble drug. Because of this reason, it is not absorbed orally. That is why any drug which ends with the word curare, curine, these are skeletal muscle relaxant, they are given by injections only because they are not absorbed orally. So if a drug is not getting absorbed orally, it will have less oral bioavailability. So any drug which ends with the word curare, curine, curium, etc., they all are skeletal muscle relaxants. Now let's come to question number 14. Which of the following drug has higher first pass metabolism in men as compared to women? So the answer is ethanol. The reason is men, they have higher amount of dehydrogenase enzyme. The dehydrogenase enzyme, which is required for the metabolism of alcohol in men, this dehydrogenase enzyme degrades or metabolizes alcohols in our body. And this dehydrogenase enzyme is present more in men as compared to females. So it is present more in males as compared to females. So ethanol. Okay, so we can remember like this, that male patient have more capacity to drink alcohol as compared to female counterpart. Now true statement about weakly acidic drug is, now the answer for this question, true statement regarding weakly acidic drug is that they are mainly absorbed from stomach, as we have already discussed that acidic drug gets absorbed from stomach. Acidic drugs, because acidic drug gets converted into lipid soluble in acidic media, and basic drugs, they get absorbed from intestine. But overall, if one question will come, remember all drugs, whether it is acidic or basic, they get absorbed from small intestine. The reason is they have greater surface area. Okay, now let's come to question number 16. All of the following cross plasma membrane except. The answer is epinephrine. Again, epinephrine is a highly lipid soluble, it is a highly ionic drug. It cannot cross cell membrane. It cannot cross cell membrane. Okay, so try to remember. While all these drugs, these two drugs, they are steroidal drugs. Steroidal drugs are, these are steroidal hormone. And we know that steroidal hormone are lipid soluble, they can easily cross. What about thyroid hormone? Thyroid hormone, our body cells have special transporters for thyroid hormone by which they can easily enter into cell membrane. Okay, so epinephrine is the answer. That is why epinephrine, when we give in shock like condition, we give by injection, we cannot give them orally. Now let's come to 17th question. All of the following drugs all these drugs except one crosses the blood-brain barrier. So the drug which will not cross blood-brain barrier is dopamine. How we can remember? As we know that dopamine cannot cross blood-brain barrier because dopamine, epinephrine, they are the type of catecholamines. So no catecholamines can cross cell membrane barrier. Okay, that is why in cases of Parkinson disease, we cannot give dopamine. In Parkinson disease, there is no role of dopamine because dopamine cannot enter into the brain. Hence, we give a lipid-soluble form, levodopa. Because levodopa can cross or enter into the brain by crossing the cell membrane barrier. Now, which of the following drug does not cross blood-brain barrier? The answer for this question is glycopyrrolate. The reason is all these three drugs, they have tertiary amine compound. Tertiary amine means NH3. While glycopyrrolate is quaternary amine compound. Quaternary means 4 bond NH4+. As we know, now the charge is coming, it is water soluble. Anything which has a charge becomes water soluble or ionic. And remember, ionic drugs cannot cross the cell membrane barrier like blood-brain barrier. While these drugs are lipid soluble or non-ionic. So it's a very important question. You must remember glycopyrrolate. That is why glycopyrrolate is given before anesthesia or during anesthesia as a pre-anesthetic medication. We prefer to give glycopyrrolate. Okay. Now, 19th question is asking. Now, the 19th question is asking, which route of the following drug avoids first pass metabolism and is used with drug preparation that slowly releases drug for long period of time? Now, the first point you must remember, the only route which undergoes first pass metabolism of liver, the only route which has first pass metabolism of liver is oral route. Now, apart from oral route, no other route has high first pass metabolism in liver. Okay, because by oral route, only by the oral route, the drug comes into the portal vein first and goes into the liver. While all other routes, they bypass the first pass metabolism liver. So, okay, so topical route, it bypasses. Transdermal, it bypasses. Sublingual, it also bypass the first pass metabolism of liver. Now, keeping this thing in mind, just imagine which of the following drug will be slowly released. For period as long as 7 days, the answer for this question number is transdermal. That is why we give transdermal patch. The drug gets continuously absorbed, gets absorbed from skin. In topical, the drug cannot enter the skin and it cannot come into our blood. While in sublingual, the drug comes suddenly into our blood. Okay, so the transdermal avoids first pass metabolism in liver and it is a very long acting preparation. So let's come to question 20. The bioavailability of the drug depends upon. The bioavailability of a drug we have already discussed depends upon the first pass metabolism of liver. Okay. Now let's come to question number 21. Now bioavailability is. Now let's see the concept of bioavailability. Bioavailability is the amount of the drug that reaches systemic circulation. This is the definition. Okay. Now, when we give a drug, the drug gets metabolized in liver before it can reach into the systemic circulation. The answer is absolutely true. Okay. The drug gets metabolized in liver after the drug reaches into the systemic circulation. The answer is false. And it is maximum bioavailable route. The answer is no. The maximum bioavailability of a drug is by IV route, intravenous route. Intravenous route have 100% bioavailability. The reason is the drug does not have to cross any cell membrane barrier. So the first is the definition and the second part is the true statement. But what the question is just asking bioavailability is. So this question is asking about the definition of bioavailability. So our answer for this question number 21 is A. It is the amount of the drug that reaches systemic circulation with time. Okay. So this is about the absorption of a drug. So let's now we will be discussing about the distribution of a drug. Okay. So now let's talk about distribution of a drug. So the first question is asking, which of the following is true? The action of a drug, phenothiazine, is terminated before they are excreted. The answer is true because phenothiazines, first they are metabolized in the body. It happens with most of the drug and they get converted into inactive form Due to inactive form, their action is terminated, and after that they are excreted into the urine. Hence, they are eliminated out of the body. Now, the second question is, drugs like lithium are not modified in the body. That means they are not metabolized. Yes, lithium is just like sodium. They don't need until they don't need any metabolism. Now, the drug elimination is not same as drug excretion. The answer is true. Excretion is means the drug is getting eliminated out in urine. But remember, elimination can be through other routes as well, like bile, sweat, saliva, etc. Hence, the answer for this question number one is D. Now, all of the following bind to tissue protein with high affinity. So, the answer is chlorpromazine. So, now the answer is why? Because digoxin, it binds to heart. That is why it is an inotropic drug. Chloroquine binds to various tissues like retina. It causes bullseye maculopathy or bullseye retinopathy. Ametine also binds to heart and it is a cardiotoxic drug. Hence, the answer is chlorpromazine. Now, identify the wrong statement. Acidic drugs bind to albumin in plasma. The answer is true, because albumin, remember this concept, that albumin is a basic plasma protein. It is a basic plasma protein and it will bind to all acidic drugs. Similarly, alpha 1 acid glycoprotein, it's an acidic plasma protein and it will bind to all basic drugs. So this concept you remember. So the first option, if we see, acidic drug binds to albumin, the answer is true. Basic drug binds to alpha 1 acid glycoprotein, the answer is true. Drugs have higher affinity for plasma protein, can displace one another, the answer is true. Now remember, the binding of these drugs to this plasma protein is non-specific. Non-specific binding means multiple drugs can bite at same site, hence one drug can displace another drug. Now the last option is the false statement. Let's see why it is false. Sex steroid hormones do not bind to any plasma protein. The answer is absolutely false. Now, sex steroid hormones like estrogen, progesterone, testosterone, etc. Remember, they are bound to a plasma protein in known as sex hormone binding globulin. So, they bind to a plasma protein known as sex hormone binding globulin. So, remember, these steroidal hormones or sex steroid hormones, estrogen, progesterone, testosterone, they rather bind to plasma protein. Hence, this is the false statement. Now, which of the following drugs should be removed by dialysis? The answer is given is salicylates. Okay, so salicylates are removed by dialysis. Okay, now let's see what is the correct answer. The best answer for this option is salicylate, but remember, you can also write benzodiazepines are also removed by dialysis. Okay, salicylates are the answer. So let's write the drugs which are removed by the dialysis. So the mnemonic we will write is BLAST. So the drugs which are removed by dialysis are, you will write, the first one is barbiturates. It is not benzodiazepine, it is rather barbiturate. Then we will write lithium. A for aspirin. A for alcohols, any alcohol like ethanol, methyl alcohol, etc. We will write salicylates and theophylline. So in their poisoning, we do hemodialysis. So try to remember this mnemonic of BLAST. So these drugs are removed by hemodialysis. Now we will also write the examples of the drugs which are not removed by hemodialysis. So the drugs which are not removed by hemodialysis are, because hemodialysis will be ineffective, we will write a mnemonic, avoid ABC. So in these drugs, there is no role of hemodialysis. The first one is amphetamines. Second is verapamil. With 1V, we will also write warfarin also. Then we will write organophosphates. I for imipramine. Imipramine is a tricyclic antidepressant, TCA, tricyclic antidepressant. D for digoxin, which is given here out here. A for amiodarone, an antiarrhythmic drug. B for benzodiazepines. And lastly, chloroquine. Against these drugs, there is no role of hemodialysis. Hence, the answer is, here we will not do hemodialysis, here we will do hemodialysis. Now, let's come to the question 5. Which of the following is true? Now, as the concentration of the drug increases over the therapeutic range, only, here the perfect option is not given, so for a moment we will skip it, we will come back to this. The bound form of a drug is not available for metabolism, but it is available for excretion. The answer is absolutely true. Absolutely false. Remember, the bound form of the drug is also available for metabolism. Because there are certain enzymes present in our plasma, they are also get metabolized by, they can metabolize bound drug. Acidic drugs bind to beta globulin. We have already written it is not beta 1 globulin, it is albumin. Acidic drugs, they bind to albumin. And basic drugs, they bind to alpha 1 acid glycoprotein, which we have already written. So this is again a false statement. So the true statement is binding sites are non-specific. We have already discussed. Because of this reason, displacement of one drug by another drug can occur. It is absolutely true. Okay. And one drug can displace another drug. So this is the true statement. Okay. Now let's come to, in a patient with nephrotic syndrome and hypoalbuminemia, plasma protein binding of which drug, the complete question is which drug is not affected. Okay, the plasma protein binding of which drug is not effective. Now we know that albumin, it binds to all acidic drugs. So if a drug is acidic and the level of albumin increases, the plasma protein binding of an acidic drug will be effective. Now among them, remember, morphine is a basic drug. Rest all other drugs are acidic drugs. So let's write the names of certain acidic drugs as well as basic drug. So I'll show you a diagram. The drugs, acidic drugs, they bind to albumin, and the basic drugs, they bind to alpha 1 acid glycoprotein. So in nephrotic syndrome, the binding of only and only acidic drugs are effective, not the basic drug. So keeping this thing in mind, let's see that diagram. Okay. So this is the diagram of the drugs which are bound to albumin. So the mnemonic is ab na work talo. That means anti-epileptic drugs, all anti-epileptic drugs are acidic. Benzodiazepines and barbiturate, NSAIDs, antimicrobials, warfarin and tolbutamide. And here we will see alpha 1 acid glycoprotein, they are basic drugs. So beta blockers, local anesthetics, antiarrhythmic, calcium channel blocker, opioid, they all are used in heart disease like condition. So they get bind to alpha 1 acid glycoprotein, they are basic drugs. Okay, so let's come back to now our question number 7. Drug distribution is influenced by, the drug distribution of a drug is influenced by. Now what do we mean by the distribution? Distribution or volume of distribution means, suppose this is a blood vessel, how much drug will remain in the blood vessel and how much drug will go and deposit in organs. Okay, if a drug is getting more deposit in organs and it is moving outside the blood vessel, so remember, volume of distribution in one word means extravascular deposition of a drug into the organs. If a drug is more getting deposited organ, it means it has high volume of distribution. The drug is more distributed in the body. Now the first point is, this volume of distribution depends upon plasma protein binding. Yes, because if a drug binds to plasma protein, these plasma protein will not allow a drug to move outside. And if the drug is lipid soluble, this drug can easily cross this cell, endothelial cell, and move outside. Degree of blood flow, yes, if an organ is receiving more blood supply, more drug will move outside. And with age, the plasma volume and plasma proteins are affected. The chemistry of organs are also affected. Hence, the answer is all of the following. Okay, all of the following. Similarly, here is also the answer is all of the following. Okay, all these factors, they change with age, pregnancy, neonate, and the body status. Now, drugs with high tissue plasma protein binding have. Drug with high tissue protein binding. It is tissue protein. Tissue means organs. So can we say that if a drug is getting bound to organs proteins, can we say the drug will be deposited in organs? It will not love to remain in a blood vessel. And we know if a drug is moving outside the blood vessel, the drug will have high volume of distribution. So the answer for our option is large volume of distribution. Okay. Now drugs with high plasma protein binding will have. Now if this drug is bound to plasma protein, these plasma protein will not allow a drug to move outside. Hence, remember, if a drug is having high plasma protein binding, the drug will have lower volume of distribution. Okay. Now, which of the following drugs will bind to albumin? We have already discussed that penicillin was acidic drug in the list we have just seen. Now, thiopentone exhibit redistribution phenomena. Why? Because it is highly lipid soluble drug. Okay, so whenever the word redistribution comes, remember the word thiopentone. Now let's understand what is redistribution. Now redistribution is a mechanism in which when we give thiopentone IV to our patient, what will happen? This thiopentone, due to high blood supply, it will go to the brain and it will produce general anesthetic effect. But when the blood will move outside the brain, because of its high lipid soluble structure, this thiopentone will get permanently deposited in fats. It will go and permanently deposited in fats. This property is known as redistribution. Because of this reason, the blood concentration of thiopentone rapidly reduces and the effect of thiopentone gets over. So effect of thiopentone gets over because of a process known as redistribution into fats. And why it is getting redistributed into fats? Because it is just like a fat, highly lipid soluble drug. So whenever the word redistribution comes, blindly mark the answer thiopentone. Okay. Now thiopentone exhibit redistribution phenomena. We already know because it is highly lipid soluble. Okay. That is why it is the shortest acting barbiturate we have, because it gets rapidly sequestered into fats. Its action is very short lived. Now all of the following drugs can cross placenta except heparin. Why? Because heparin is 100% water soluble drug or ionic drug. It is the strongest acidic or ionic substance of our body. And remember, only a lipid soluble drug can cross any cell membrane barrier like placenta. Hence the answer is heparin. Now blood brain barrier is crossed by, the answer for this question number is physostigmine and propanolol. Now let's see why not glycopyrrolate and dopamine. Now remember, dopamine is a catecholamine. Now remember, catecholamines, they are 100% water soluble compound, hence they cannot cross any cell membrane barrier. And this glycopyrrolate is a quaternary amine means nitrogen with four bond. Because of this reason, it has ionic character. But if you compare it with physostigmine is a tertiary amine means it is NH3 character. Because of NH3 character, it is lipid soluble. Hence, physostigmine will cross cell membrane barrier, while not glycopyrrolate. Now, what about propanolol? Propanolol is also a lipid soluble drug. That is why it is given orally and by all other routes. It produces a side effect of nightmares and seizures in our brain. Now, apparent volume of distribution is more than total fluid of a drug. So the question is indirectly asking us, there is a drug whose apparent volume of distribution is more than the total body fluid. It means that if we talk about the total body fluid, we have fluid in our blood vessels, then we have fluid in our interstitium, okay, then we have cells, okay. So we generally consider total body fluid as cell, interstitium, inside the cell, intracellular, extracellular could be interstitial and intravascular, which is present in the blood vessel. Now the point is, if the drug is present, 100% present in the blood vessel only, this drug does not move outside, we call that the drug has lowest volume of distribution. And as the drug will move outside into the tissue, more it will move outside the tissue from interstitium into the cell. Remember, the volume of distribution gradually increases. Okay. More the drug will enter into the cell, more the volume of distribution increases. Hence, if the volume of distribution is more than the total body fluid, the answer is the drug will be permanently deposited into the cells. Okay. So more the drug will move outside extravascularly, more the volume of distribution. Now, hemodialysis is useful in all of the following, except we have already discussed that mnemonic, that is digoxin poisoning. Okay. So in digoxin poisoning, there is no role of hemodialysis. So this is about distribution. So now let's start with the word metabolism, the third parameter of pharmacokinetic. Now remember, metabolism is also known as biotransformation. It is also known as drug disposition. And it is also known as xenobiotics. These are the other names of metabolism. Now remember the word metabolism, what do we mean? In metabolism, we convert a lipid soluble drug into water soluble. so that this drug is eliminated out of the body, because the drug gets eliminated out of the body through secretion. So this is the definition of metabolism. Now, how we will convert this lipid soluble drug into water soluble? First, we will convert this drug into smaller particles. We'll break this drug down. So this is known as phase one reaction. Okay. And after that, in phase two reaction, what we will be doing, we will attach a water soluble group into this lipid soluble molecule, and the drug will become water soluble. So as we are attaching a water soluble group, phase two reaction is also known as conjugation reaction. Okay, conjugation reaction. So let's see what are the various reactions which we do in phase one and phase two. So the reactions in phase one and phase two are, we will write. So we will write the list of those reactions. So the reactions are, in phase one reaction, the reactions are oxidation, reduction, cyclization, decyclization, and hydrolysis. In phase two, we have glucuronide conjugation. We will attach a glucuronide group. We will attach glutathione, acetyl, sulfation, methylation, and glycine conjugation. So here we are attaching a water soluble group in blue, phase two reaction, conjugation, while in phase one, we are breaking the drug into smaller particle, hence oxidation, reduction, etc. Now just remember, all phase one reaction, they occur in microsomes. Where is the location inside the liver cell? They occur in microsomes. Microsomes means smooth endoplasmic reticulum of the liver. Now all phase two reaction, remember, they are non-microsomal. That means they occur outside the smooth endoplasmic reticulum, in mitochondria, cytoplasm, etc., except only one. The only phase two reaction which occurs in microsome is glutathione, that is glucuronidation. It is the only phase two reaction or conjugation reaction that occurs in microsomes. So this is the exception. So all phase one reaction occur in microsome, and glucuronide conjugation in phase two occur in microsome. Rest all other phase two reaction, they occur outside the microsomes. So the question number one is asking that which of the following reactions is an example of microsomal conjugation. Conjugation means phase two reaction, and which is occurring in microsome. So the answer for this question is glucuronide conjugation. So answer is glucuronide conjugation. Okay, now let's come to about this phase one reaction. The most common phase one reaction we do in our body is CYP. This CYP enzyme causes oxidation, reduction, and epoxide formation. This is the most common phase one reaction which is done with majority of the drug, and there are various types of CYP enzymes. Okay, so I'll just show you the list of the drugs which are metabolized by various CYP enzymes. So this is the list, that is CYP3A4. So the drugs are estimazole, benzodiazepine like diazepam, etc., C for cisapride, D for calcium channel blocker, diltiazamine, verapamil, estrogens, fexofenadine, grapefruit juice, HMG CoA reductase inhibitor like statin. So the mnemonic is ABCDGH. Then we have CYP2D6, the mnemonic is Batson. Beta blocker like propranolol, carbidolol, antiarrhythmics like amiodarone, tricyclic antidepressant, SSRIs, opioids, and neuroleptic like haloperidol. Then we have CYP2C8, 2C9, that is phenytoin and warfarin, and CYP2C19, clopidogrel, proton pump inhibitor, and voriconazole CBP. Now remember, this CYP3A4 is present in our body in maximum amount, CYP3A4, and it is responsible for metabolism of most of the drugs. While this CYP2C8 and 2C9, phenytoin and warfarin, it is present in our body in minimum amount. Okay? So keep this thing in mind about CYP enzymes. So let's keeping this thing in mind in our question, the mitochondrial enzyme involved in metabolism of clopidogrel and proton pump inhibitor. The drug which is responsible for metabolism of clopidogrel and proton pump inhibitor is CYP2C19. Hence the answer is CYP2C19. Okay. Now which of the following is wrongly meshed regarding drug elimination? We know that calcium channel blocker is diltiazamine verapamil. It is metabolized by CYP3A4. It's true. Beta blockers like carvedilol, CYP2D6. Digoxin is not metabolized by any CYP. It is rather pumped out of the cell by the kidney. pumped out of the cell by P glycoprotein? The answer is true. While we know that statins, they are metabolized by CYP3A4. So this is the false statement, D. Now, which of the following is a prodrug? Examples of prodrug. Now, what are prodrug? Prodrugs are inactive drug. Through metabolism in our body, they get converted into active form. So let's write the list of the prodrugs. Okay, let's write the list of the prodrugs. So you'll write a mnemonic of prodrugs, that is plasma CD. Okay, P for prednisone. The active form of prednisone is prednisolone. Then we have levodopa, active form is dopamine. ACE inhibitors, all ACE inhibitors like enalapril are prodrug, except two ACE inhibitors which are not prodrug, that is captopril and lisinopril. Sulfasalazine, mercaptopurine, minoxidil and methyldopa. All cyclovir drug are prodrug like acyclovir, ganciclovir. Then our antiplatelet drug known as clopidogrel, anti-cancer drug cyclophosphamide, and anti-thyroid drug carbimazole. Carbimazole, its active form is methimazole. And lastly, we have a anti-glaucoma drug, that is dipivefrine. The active form is epinephrine. Okay, so this mnemonic you must remember about the prodrugs, that is plasma CD. So keep this thing in mind. So all ACE inhibitors are prodrug except captopril and lisinopril. So keep this thing in mind. Let's see the question number fourth. Which of the following is a prodrug? The answer is enalapril. So enalapril is a prodrug. It's a kind of ACE inhibitor. Now, which of the following drug is an inhibitor of CYP450 system? Now we have discussed about CYP system. Now remember, CYP enzymes, its activity can be increased or decreased. So if we increase the activity of CYP enzyme, it is known as enzyme inducer. And if we reduce the activity of CYP enzyme, it is known as enzyme inhibitor. Okay, so it will affect with the metabolism of a drug. So among enzyme inducer, we will write a mnemonic GPRS, stop, CCD. Okay, G for one antifungal drug, griseofulvin. P for you will write phenytoin, phenobarbital, carbamazepine. What these drugs are? All these drugs are anti-epileptic. So you will write all anti-epileptic drugs are enzyme inducer, except one, except valproate, the most commonly used anti-epileptic drug, valproate. Remember, valproate is rather an enzyme inhibitor. R for anti-tubercular drug, rifampicin. We will write isoniazid will be an enzyme inhibitor. Smoking or smoked meat. You'll write St. John Wort. It's an herbal medication used for the treatment of depression. Tolbutamide. We will write phenylbutazone. It's an NSAID. Then we will write chloral hydrate, chronic alcohol or ethanol or alcohol, which, and lastly DDT, insecticide. So this is the complete list of enzyme inducer, GPRS, CHOP, CCD. Let's talk about the list of enzyme inhibitors that will include valproate and isoniazid. The list we will write is COK, IVC, GAP. So C for cimetidine, it is the first H2 blocker given for peptic ulcer. You'll write not ranitidine. Omeprazole, which is a proton pump inhibitor. All PPIs you will write are enzyme inhibitors. Ketoconazole, antifungal drug. Erythromycin, isoniazid, remember, inhibit all CYP except CYP2E1. Okay, then you will write valproate. C for ciprofloxacin, very important question. G for grapefruit juice. Okay, while because grapefruit juice, they contain one chemical known as furanocoumarin. Furanocoumarin present in grapefruit juice act as an enzyme
inhibitor, one gout drug allopurinol, and antiarrhythmic drug amiodarone. And lastly, we will write protease inhibitor. Protease inhibitor are used in HIV infection like ritonavir. They end with the word navir. So this is the complete list: Coke, IVC, and GAP. So remember this list of enzyme inducers and inhibitors wholeheartedly. It's a very important list, and question comes very commonly from this list. Okay, question comes very commonly from this list. So keeping this list in mind, let's solve one question number 5. Which of the following is an enzyme inhibitor? The answer for this question is ketoconazole. Ketoconazole is an enzyme inhibitor, we have written here, while all other drugs are enzyme inducers. These drugs are rather enzyme inducers. In the metabolism or xenobiotics, all of the following reaction occur in phase 1 except. So we know that phase 2 reaction are known as conjugation reaction. So oxidation, reduction, and hydrolysis are phase 1 reaction. Conjugation is phase 2 reaction. All of the following result in detoxification of a drug except. The answer is all CYP are important for phase 1 reaction except this CYP. Cytochrome oxidase is not responsible for metabolism of a drug. Okay. Now, which of the following antiplatelet drug is a prodrug? We had written in our mnemonic clopidogrel. CYP3A4 enzyme is affected by. So ABCDH, the answer is A, B, and C. Okay. While penicillin and azithromycin are not metabolized by any CYP enzyme. CYP450 inducer. Inducer, remember the mnemonic GPRS, stop CCD. So P for phenobarbital, enzyme inducer, anti-epileptic, DDT. So these are the answer. Which of the following are prodrug? Remember the mnemonic plasma CD. So mercaptopurine is a prodrug, yes. Dipivefrine is a prodrug, active form is epinephrine. Enalapril ACE inhibitor is also a prodrug. The answer is all of the following above. High first pass metabolism is seen in, it's an example of absorption part. So just refer to the videos of absorption. Okay. We had already written a mnemonic PMVP sing. The answer is all of the following. Okay. So we had written the high first pass metabolism HILT and PMVP sing mnemonic. So these are the drugs which are having a high first pass metabolism. In hepatic metabolism, all are phase 2 reaction except. So we have to find that sulfation, we are attaching a water soluble group sulfate. Yes, it is a phase 2 reaction. Methylation, again we are attaching something. Glucuronidation, again we are attaching something. But in deamination, we are removing something. D word is coming. So we are breaking the drug into smaller particle. So it must be a phase 1 reaction. So the answer is deamination. Deamination is an example of phase 1 reaction. All other reactions are phase 2. Which does not induce microsomal enzyme. Which of the following does not induce microsomal enzyme? The answer is cimetidine. Cimetidine is rather an inhibitor of microsomal enzyme. While GPRS we had discussed are the example of enzyme inhibitor. All of the following, which of the following is a prodrug? The answer is levodopa. The active form of levodopa is dopamine. Which of the following drug does not have active metabolite? That means you have to remove which is not a prodrug. The answer is all ACE inhibitors are prodrug except captopril and lisinopril. Which of the following is a prodrug? The answer is carbimazole. Its active form is methimazole. Which of the following drug do not produce active metabolite? The answer is again lisinopril. Captopril and lisinopril are not prodrug. So please refer to that mnemonic we have discussed. Which of the following is not an oxidative type of drug metabolism? Remember, oxidation occurs in phase 1 reaction. So the question is asking which of the following is not a phase 1 reaction? The answer is glucuronide conjugation. Glucuronide conjugation is a phase 2 reaction. Which of the following is phase 1 metabolic reaction? Phase 1 metabolic reaction is hydroxylation. Other conjugation, glucuronidation, and sulfation are phase 2 reaction. In drug metabolism, hepatic CYP450 system is responsible for. We know that it is responsible for phase 1 reaction. Okay? of hydrolysis, oxidation and reduction. Okay, one of the potential microsomal enzyme inhibitor drug is, we have to find enzyme inhibitors, Coke, IVC, GAP. So the answer is sodium valproate. All antiepileptics are enzyme inducers except valproate, which is an enzyme inhibitor. One of the most potent microsomal enzyme inducer, GPRS, R for rifampicin. Okay, rifampicin is an enzyme inducer. CYP450 most commonly involved in drug metabolism. The answer was CYP3A4. It is responsible for maximum metabolism of most of the drugs. Which of the following is an enzyme inhibitor? The answer is COK-COK, ketoconazole. Which of the following is an enzyme inhibitor again? Ketoconazole. Now, which drug is not metabolized by acetylation? Now, acetylation is a type of phase 2 reaction. And we will write the drugs which get metabolized by phase 2 reaction are SHIP-C, that is sulfonamide. Remember, all sulfonamide, they start with the word sulfa, except to the first leprosy drug. Dapsone, anti-leprosy drug, was also a sulfonamide. And the first anti-tubercular drug, para-aminosalicylic acid, also known as PAS, is also a sulfonamide. One anti-hypertensive drug, hydralazine. One anti-tubercular drug, isoniazid. P for procainamide. One antiarrhythmic and benzodiazepine, clonazepam. So these are the drugs which get metabolized by acetylation. Okay, and remember, all these drugs, they produce a common side effect known as SLE, systemic lupus erythematosus, or drug induced SLE, one and the same thing, which is also known as DLE. Okay, so the question is asking, which of the following is not metabolized by acetylation? The answer is metoclopromide. It is not metabolized by acetylation. All of the following can cause SLE like syndrome, except the answer is penicillin. Okay, penicillin, SHIP drugs, they cause SLE like reactions. Now, biotransformation or metabolism is, now remember, when we are changing a drug into lipid soluble into water soluble, this is what metabolism or biotransformation means. What will happen to the activity of a drug? Remember, everything can happen to the activity of the drug. Most commonly, an active drug gets converted into inactive molecule. And it happens most commonly, and the action of a drug is over. But what other things can happen? Active drug can form active metabolites, and sometimes an inactive drug through metabolism can be converted into active form. Okay, and this last one is known as prodrugs. So with activity, anything can happen. Hence the answer is all of the following. Okay, hence the answer is all of the following. And inactive drug can be form active drug. This is known as prodrug. Active can form another active, inactive form. Yes, active can form active. Okay, everything can occur. Now, phase 1 reactions are degradative reaction. The answer is yes, true. Why? Because a smaller molecule is formed. It is a conversion of smaller non-polar molecule by introduction of a new group. Yes, we oxidize, we reduce. They are microsomal, true. So the answer is all of the following. False regarding phase 2 reaction. Now, phase 2 reaction, we already know they are known as conjugation reaction. The answer is absolutely true. They may be catalyzed by microsomal, that is glucuronide, and outside microsome in mitochondria and cytoplasm enzymes. The answer is absolutely true. They are mainly microsomal? No. Remember, they are mainly non-microsomal. That means they occur outside the smooth endoplasmic reticulum. The only exception was glucuronide conjugation. The only microsomal phase 1 reaction was glucuronide conjugation. So this statement is false. And what is the purpose of metabolism or phase 2 reaction? To convert a lipid soluble drug into water soluble. Hence this answer is also true. Okay. So the incorrect statement in our question is C. They are not mainly microsomal. They are mainly non-microsomal. All are the examples of non-microsomal conjugation, except we know that only glucuronide conjugation is microsomal conjugation. Hence the answer is B. Rest all other reaction of conjugation or phase 2 reaction, they occur outside the microsomes. Now this question have been repeated by mistake. So the answer is all of the following. Phase 1 reaction, all. Okay, They are mainly microsomal, we had discussed, and glucuronide conjugation. Same questions have been repeated. Now, which of the following drug inhibit microsomal enzyme? So we have to find an enzyme inhibitor. So if you see the list, we had written amiodarone. Okay. Rest all other drugs, ethanol, phenobarbital, and rifampicin are enzyme inducers. All of the following drugs undergo hepatic metabolism before excretion, except the answer is penicillin G. So let's write the list of certain drugs which are not metabolized in liver, which are not metabolized in liver, they are excreted unchanged in urine. The answers are penicillin G, lithium, tigecycline, and low molecular weight heparin. Try to remember these four options which are commonly asked. These drugs are not metabolized in liver. They are excreted unchanged in urine. Now, all of the following drugs can cause SLE-like syndrome. So try to find ship drug except. So the exception is again penicillin. All of the following anti-epileptics are enzyme inducers except. The only anti-epileptic which is an enzyme inhibitor was valproate. Which of the following is an effect of grapefruit juice on drug metabolism? We know that grapefruit juice contains furanocoumarin, and furanocoumarin act as an enzyme inhibitor. About biotransformation, false is. The main purpose of biotransformation or metabolism is to convert a lipid soluble drug into water soluble so that it can be eliminated out of the body. So the answer is, this is a false statement. The more fat soluble substances are not formed. Okay. It is rather more lipid soluble, more water soluble substances are formed. And what can happen to the activity of a drug when we are transforming? Anything can happen. Inactive metabolites can be formed. Active metabolites can also be formed. Which of the following can result in oral contraceptive failure? Remember, oral contraceptive failure contains estrogen. And estrogen is metabolized by CYP3A4 enzyme. And any drug which is an enzyme inducer can lead to contraceptive failure, because it will increase the degradation of or metabolism of estrogen. So try to find a list of enzyme inducer. Remember, enzyme inducers causes oral contraceptive failure. So here you can find the answer as rifampicin. So rifampicin causes contraceptive failure. So that is why we never combine oral contraceptive pills, especially estrogen containing pills, with rifampicin. Now, which of the following drug is not a prodrug? So the answer for this question is, that is not a prodrug, that is amoxicillin. So just go through the list. Which of the following is a prodrug? So the answer is enalapril, the drug which may inhibit CYP450 system of warfarin. So you have to find an enzyme inhibitor in this case. We know that enzyme inhibitor is cimetidine, COKE. So this is about metabolism of a drug. Now let's discuss the questions of elimination now. So the first question is asking about elimination, that all of the following statements are true except. So we have to find the incorrect statement. So for the drug with active metabolite, elimination of a parent molecule by metabolism is not synonymous with termination of action. The answer is absolutely true. The reason is, when the drug gets metabolized, it is not necessarily that after every time a drug becomes inactive. Certain drugs can become active even after metabolism. Examples are prodrugs. Okay, so this is a true statement. A small number of drugs combined irreversibly with their receptors so that disappearance from the bloodstream is not equivalent to cessation of action. The answer is absolutely true. These drugs are known as hit and run drugs. These kinds of drugs. Drug elimination is same as drug excretion. The answer is absolutely false. Remember, elimination is removal of a drug out of the body. Excretion is specifically for urinary excretion. Okay, excretion denotes term urinary. For the drug that are not metabolized, excretion is the mode of elimination. The answer is absolutely true. Okay, the answer is absolutely true. So let's see what is the difference between elimination and excretion. Now remember, elimination means the drug must be removed out of the body, and for that the drug must be metabolized first. and the drug must be excreted out in urine. So this complete process is generally known as elimination of a drug. So these two things generally comprise, and when the drug is excreted out in urine, it is specifically known as excretion. While elimination of a drug is not necessarily that it must be from urine only. Okay, now let's come to, so the answer is this one, false. The pharmacokinetic property process or property that distinguish the elimination of ethanol and high dose of phenytoin and aspirin from elimination from most of the drug is, remember, these drugs, they undergo zero order kinetics. Okay, so these drugs, they undergo zero order kinetics. So let's see what are the examples of the drugs that undergo zero order kinetics. So you will write a mnemonic: the drugs that undergo zero order elimination, which is also known as saturation elimination, are, the mnemonic is WhatsApp. Okay, so W for warfarin, high molecular weight heparin, A for alcohol, T for theophylline, anti-asthma drug, T for, you'll write, tolbutamide, S for salicylates, which is consist of aspirin but in high dose only, aspirin. Okay, then we will write phenylbutazone, it's an NSAID, and lastly phenytoin. So this is the complete list of the drugs that undergo first zero order kinetics. Okay, and try to remember three, ATP, and remember, among alcohol, it shows only pure zero order kinetics. Alcohol shows pure zero order kinetics or saturation elimination, while other drugs in very high dose, they show zero order, and in low dose, they show first order. Now let's come to the third question. Which of the following statement best describe the process by which plasma concentration of a drug declines with first order kinetic? The answer for this question is B. The half-life remains the same as compared to the plasma concentration. Okay, so if you see the other options, the first one is, there is only one metabolic pathway for elimination. The answer is absolutely false. There are many metabolic pathway. The drug is largely metabolized in liver after oral administration and has low bioavailability. It has nothing to relate with elimination of a drug. The rate of elimination is proportional to the rate of administration of drug at all times. The answer is absolutely no. It only occurs in, it is absolutely false. It only occurs when the steady state concentration is achieved. Hence the answer is B. Now alkaline diuresis is done for the treatment of poisoning due to. Now remember, alkaline diuresis is done for the treatment of the drug which are weak acidic drug. In weak acidic drug poisoning, we change the pH of urine alkaline, so the drug becomes more water soluble and easily gets excreted out into the urine. So remember, the answer is of this question is C, phenobarbital. So we will just see the list of the drugs in which we will do alkaline diuresis. Alkaline diuresis is done for acidic drug. Similarly, acidic diuresis is done for basic drugs. So let's see the list of those drugs here, where we do forced alkaline diuresis and forced acidic diuresis. Okay, so drug removed by forced diuresis are these drugs. So in the left side, we are seeing forced alkaline diuresis. It is done for weakly acidic drugs. And forced acidic diuresis, it is done for weakly alkaline or basic drugs. It is done by sodium bicarbonate. And forced acidic diuresis is done for ammonium chloride. So the drugs are NSAIDs like aspirin, methotrexate, barbiturate like phenobarbital, imipramine, chlorpromamide. And here the mnemonic is atropine, strychnine, morphine, amphetamine and quinine. So these are the drugs in which we will do forced alkaline diuresis and forced acidic diuresis. So the answer is barbiturate, that is phenobarbital, where we will be doing forced alkaline diuresis. Okay, so our answer was phenobarbital. Now alkalinization of urine is required for decreasing the poisoning. Again, the same answer is barbiturate. Alkalinization of urine is required to treat the toxicity of all of the following except amphetamine. Remember, in amphetamine we rather do forced acidic diuresis. We do acidification of urine, not alkalinization. We rather do acidification of urine. Now, which of the following is false or untrue statement? So, which of the following is not true? If the drug is administered rectally, it will follow first order kinetics. Okay. If the drug is administered intramuscular, it will show zero order kinetic. If the drug is administered IV, it will show first order kinetic. Now, remember, the route of administration of a drug, it does not tell us about the elimination of a drug. It has no relation with the order of kinetics. Hence, all these three statements A, B and C are false statement, because the route of the drug administration does not determine by which speed or by which order of kinetic the drug will be eliminated outside. Hence, A, B, C are incorrect statement. Okay. Now, next is, bioavailability is usually lower after oral administration than IV administration. The answer is absolutely true. So, this statement is true. But you have to find the untrue statement. So, the answer is A, B and C. A, B and C are untrue statement. Now, remember, IV or when we give a drug intravenously, the bioavailability of a drug is 100%. Okay, 100%. Okay, try to remember. Now, let's come to question number 8. Which of the following parameters signifies the effective drug removal from the body? The power of a body to remove a drug is known as clearance capacity of the body. Okay, so clearance is the power of an organ for to remove a drug out of the body. Now, true statement about first order kinetics. The first order kinetic, remember, a constant amount of a drug is eliminated? No. It is rather a constant fraction or proportion of a drug is eliminated. So we will write rather a constant proportion of a drug eliminated. Instead of the word amount, we will write fraction. Half-life increases with increases in dose? You will write no. Half-life is constant in first order kinetics. Rate of elimination is constant? No. The rate of elimination is directly proportional to the concentration of the drug. The rate of elimination is proportional to the plasma concentration. The answer is absolutely true. So this is the absolutely true statement regarding first order kinetics. Okay, so the answer is D. Remember, the original statements of ABC stands for zero order kinetics. Okay. So now let's come to question number 10. First order kinetics is characterized by dose dependent elimination. The answer is if you talk about 10th option, dose dependent elimination, the answer is no. Okay, then decreasing clearance as plasma concentration increases, the answer is no, because the here plasma concentration clearance capacity of an organ remains same. Increasing the rate of elimination as plasma concentration increases, the answer is absolutely true. Remember, in first order kinetic, the rate of elimination is directly proportional to concentration of the drug. No relation between elimination and plasma concentration? False. No. So the answer is C. Zero order kinetic is followed by all of the following drugs except, we have already written those answers. The answer is barbiturates. Okay, the WhatsApp was the mnemonic. At toxic doses, zero order kinetic is seen with, the answer is phenytoin. Zero order kinetic is shown by all of the following except, the answer is methotrexate. Okay, the elimination of alcohol follows pure zero order kinetics. We have already discussed. The clearance of a drug means, clearance is the amount, what is clearance? Now, clearance, remember, it is the power of a body to remove a drug. Suppose this is the kidney and the blood which is coming through plasma. In plasma, there is a drug which is coming to the kidney. And what is the power of this organ or a kidney to remove a drug out of the body? This is known as clearance capacity. So in other words, the clearance capacity means it is the volume of plasma which is cleared of the drug per unit time. In how much amount of time this plasma becomes free of that drug, this is known as clearance capacity of an organ. Now, zero order kinetics occurs in following drug with high dose. The answer is phenytoin and theophylline. Remember the mnemonic WhatsApp? Zero order kinetic means, now zero order kinetic means a constant amount of a drug is eliminated. Okay, so let's write the differences between first order and zero order kinetics. First order kinetics, kinetic means by what speed the drug will be eliminated out of the body. Zero order kinetics. Remember, in first order kinetic, a constant amount of a drug is removed. Sorry, a constant fraction of a drug is removed. In zero order kinetic, a constant amount of a drug is removed out of the body. Here, elimination is directly proportional to concentration. Here, elimination is independent of the concentration, it is constant. Here, half-life is constant. It doesn't change. Here, half-life is variable and it is directly proportional to the initial concentration. So, just exchange these two points. Okay. And last point is, in first order kinetics, we will write the graph of plasma concentration graph, concentration time graph is exponential. There is exponential decrease. Here, plasma concentration time graph is a linear line, linear decay or linear line. So these are the four points you must remember about first order kinetic and zero order kinetic. The basis is, in first order kinetic, the clearance capacity of an organ is very high. As the power of an organ to remove a drug is very high, so as you will increase the drug, the more amount of the drug will be eliminated. That is why concentration is equal to elimination of the drug. Okay. While in zero order kinetic, the clearance capacity of the organ is very low. Okay. Very low. Or sometimes it is very low or constant. Okay. So this is the difference. Now let's talk about question number 18 about first order kinetics. True statement about first order kinetic is, we have already written, the clearance capacity of an organ is very high. Okay. Here the fixed amount of the drug is eliminated. No. Here the fixed proportion of a drug is eliminated. Half-life increases with dose. No. Here the half-life is constant. Decrease clearance with increasing the dose. The answer is no. Here there is increase in clearance of a drug by increasing the dose. So the answer becomes clearance. The clearance remains constantly very high. The clearance capacity remains constantly very high. Now, urinary acidifying agents are administered in cases of poisoning. Due to which drug? So we acidify urine in weak basic drug poisoning. Okay, weak basic drug poisoning, we acidify urine. In weak acidic drug poisoning, we will give alkalinization of urine. Why? Because weakly basic drug, they change their character, water soluble or lipid soluble, in the presence of alternating pH. So weakly basic drugs, they become more water soluble in acidic media. While strongly ionic drugs or strongly acidic or basic drug, they are not influenced by changing the pH of the media in which they are. So it is always weak. Weak word is also very important. Okay. Now, true statement about weakly acidic drug is, they are bound to alpha 1 acid glycoprotein. The answer is no. They are rather bound to albumin. They're excreted faster in acidic urine. The answer is no. They are rather excreted faster in basic or alkaline urine. They will become more water soluble. They are highly ionized in intestinal juice. The answer is no. They are highly ionized in stomach juice. They are highly non-ionized in intestinal juice. The answer is no. They are highly non-ionized in stomach juice, because acidic drug in an acidic media of stomach will become non-ionized. And the last option is, they are absorbed mainly from stomach. The answer is true, because weakly acidic drug becomes lipid soluble in stomach. So the answer is B, they are absorbed from stomach. Now, which of the following drugs are secreted out in breast milk? Now remember, all drugs are secreted out in breast milk. Okay, if such kind of a question will come, mark the option as all. Which of the following is excreted out in saliva? The drugs which are excreted out in saliva, you will write the answer as lithium. So we will write those examples of the drugs which are excreted out in saliva. The first is lithium, iodides, rifampicin. You will write mercury and other metals. Mercury and other metals. So these are the drugs which are excreted out in saliva. Okay. Now forced alkaline diuresis is effective in management of poisoning off. So we are changing the pH of urine alkaline. So find an acidic drug, that is phenobarbital. Okay, phenobarbital. So let's come to the next part of pharmacokinetic, that is half-lives and dosage method of a drug. Okay, so duration of IV administered drug depends upon, the answer is all of the following. Okay, now remember, duration of action is also known as half-life. It depends upon 0.693, volume of distribution upon clearance capacity. Now this volume of distribution depends upon plasma protein binding. It depends upon lipid solubility. Okay, so plasma protein binding, volume of distribution and lipid solubility, and CL stand for clearance. Hence, the duration of action or half-life depends upon all these factors. Now, loading dose depends upon following factors except. Now, if you talk about certain formulas in loading dose, the formula of loading dose is, which is sometimes you can write as initial dose also, is equal to volume of distribution and the concentration you want to achieve in plasma, which is also known as desired concentration or steady state concentration. So remember, volume of distribution depends upon VD. VD stands for volume of distribution loading dose. Okay, so remember this part. It also depends upon drug concentration you want to achieve. Absolutely right. Okay, now the point is, it also depends upon the bioavailability of a drug, but remember, it does not depend upon the clearance of the drug. Okay, because clearance will determine the maintenance dose. It determines rather maintenance dose. So what is the definition of maintenance dose? Maintenance dose is equal to clearance capacity into concentration you want to achieve in plasma. Same concentration. So remember, maintenance dose depends upon clearance, loading dose depends upon volume of distribution. Okay, and volume of distribution, okay, volume of distribution. Now loading dose of a drug primarily depends upon, again the same question, that is primarily it depends upon the volume of distribution. A true statement regarding the first order kinetics is, now rate of elimination is independent of plasma concentration. It is absolutely false. The rate of elimination is directly proportional to the plasma concentration in first order kinetics. A constant proportion of a drug is removed. The answer is absolutely true. The constant proportion of a drug is removed in first order kinetic. Half-life increases with dose. It is false, because half-life is constant in first order kinetics. Clearance decreases with dose. False. Remains. Remember, clearance is very high and clearance is constant. It is very high. It is not decreasing with dose. So the answer is B. Now, after IV drug administration, elimination of a drug depends upon. Elimination of a drug depends upon. We will write the answer as all of the following. Okay, now remember, elimination elimination of a drug, remember, it is equal to, elimination of a drug is equal to clearance into concentration. Okay, clearance into concentration of a drug. Okay, clearance and concentration of a drug. So the drug concentration is there, the clearance is also there. Okay, now the point is, when you have initially given a drug, how much concentration there will it will be achieved, that depends upon how much drug will be present inside the blood. Okay, it will be present inside the blood. Now suppose initially the drug 100 was present. Now the dose of a drug is reduced to 50. So the drug is getting eliminated out of the body. So the time required by our body to remake a drug half is known as half-life of a drug. So half-life is equal to 0.693 volume of distribution upon clearance. And this VD upon CL, when we write it as opposite, it is also known as 0.693 upon K. It is also known as 0.693 upon K. So K is equal to here known as elimination rate constant. Elimination here is known as, K is known as elimination rate constant. It is also known as clearance upon VD. So this K tells us about the speed or what factors the volume, on what factors the elimination of a drug depends. So it depends upon the clearance, which we have already written. It depends upon the volume of distribution. And remember, volume of distribution depends upon the lipid solubility of a drug. Okay? It depends upon the lipid solubility of a drug. Now, the question number 70. A 70 kg man is given a dose in 100 milligram per kg of body weight. So what is the total amount of the dose we have given? So the total amount of the dose we have given is 70 into 100 milligram. This is the total amount of the dose we have given to that individual. So multiply this 70 by 100. Its half-life is 10 hours. And its initial plasma concentration is 1.59 milligram per ml. The true statement is, now we know the formula of half-life. We know that the formula of half-life is 0.693 upon K. Agreed? So can we say the K, which is elimination rate constant, we know that half-life is here is 10 hours. So we can easily calculate K. K will come out to be 0.693 into 10. Divided by 10, because the 10 will come downwards. So the K will come out to be 0.0693. Do you agree? So this statement is absolutely fine. Okay. Now the point is, if you talk about the initial plasma concentration is given, the initial plasma concentration is given. What else we can calculate? The other options which is given is of clearance. Now remember, what is clearance? Now the clearance of a drug, remember, is equal to, the clearance of a drug is equal to, can we say, the clearance of a drug is equal to, it is equal to the dose, sorry, so you'll write another easy formula, that there is a formula known as dose given or initial dose is equal to clearance into concentration. Clearance into concentration. Now the point is, sorry, just a moment, we just got a little bit out of our trajectory. So this is the correct answer. Now the question is, 70 kg man is given at a dose of 100 milligram. So this is the initial dose given. So we know that initial dose given is 7000. Now remember, initial dose is equal to, it is always equal to volume of distribution and the concentration you want to achieve. Now initial dose which is given is 7000 milligram, that is VD, and the concentration you achieved was 1.5 milligram per ml. So we can easily calculate now volume of distribution. The volume of distribution of this drug came out to be 7000 upon 1.9. Okay, 1.9. So now this is the volume of distribution, that is in ml. So don't solve it further. Now we can keep this formula in the half-life formula. We know that half-life is 0.693 VD upon CL. Agreed? And we know that half-life of a drug is given, that is 10 hours, 0.693. VD is already given, that is 7000 upon 1.9, and it is divided by clearance. So now we can calculate clearance. The clearance will come out to be 0.693 into 7000 upon 1.9 into 10. Okay, So if you will solve this question, everything will cut off, okay? And the clearance of a person will come out to be 0.02 liters per hour. It will come out to be this. So this is the method. First of all, calculate the K. Then calculate the volume of distribution and keep this volume of distribution in a formula of half-life. So the next answer which will come out to be will be this option. Clearance is 0.2 liters per hour. Okay. Now let's come to the question number 7. The elimination after 4 half-lives of a drug is, the answer for this question is 93%. And it's very simple. We know that in 0 half-life, 100% of the drug is present in the blood. In first half-life, 150% is present in the blood, while 50% gets eliminated out of the body. In second half-life, 25% will become present in the blood, 75% will be eliminated. In the third half-life, 12.5, 87.5. In the fourth half-life, it will be 6.25 and 93.75. So in the fourth half-life, 93.75% of the drug will be eliminated and only 6.25% of the drug will remain in the blood. So the answer is 93. It's a very simple maths. Now the amount of the drug left after 4 plasma half-life. Left after 4 plasma half-life will be 0.6.25. Now interdose interval, it depends upon. Now interdose interval is also known as maintenance dose. And maintenance dose, remember, it depends upon clearance into the plasma concentration of the drug, and clearance also depends upon the half-life of a drug. So these are the three factors on which the maintenance dose or dosage interval depends, that is clearance, concentration and half-life of a drug. Okay, so and loading dose, we had already discussed, depends only and only on half-life. Maintenance dose depends upon clearance, concentration and half-life. So you will write this. So we will just make a summary that maintenance dose of a drug, you will write maintenance dose of a drug depends upon clearance, concentration and half-life of a drug. Okay, loading dose of a drug depends upon only and only volume of distribution. So just write this mnemonic that maintenance dose depends upon three factors, that is clearance, concentration and half-life. Loading dose only depends upon volume of distribution. Okay. Now let's come to question number 10. Time required to reach the steady state concentration after dosage regimen depends upon the half-life of a drug. Now the time to reach steady state concentration, that means if you will give a drug continuously to your patient after one time, what will happen? The further dose of a drug will not increase in the plasma. The plasma concentration will not increase with time if you are giving the drug with constant rate of infusion. Okay, so this concentration which is achieved is known as steady state concentration, and this steady state concentration takes 4 to 5 half-lives to achieve. It depends upon the half-life of a drug. So a drug requires 4 to 5 half-lives to achieve a steady state concentration. Better answer is 5 half-life. So remember, steady state concentration depends upon half-life of a drug. Now question number 11. A patient admitted to the hospital with cough, shortness of breath and fever, and is later diagnosed to be suffering from pneumonia due to gram-negative bacteria. Tobramycin is to be started. The clearance of a drug and VD of a patient, tobramycin is given. So clearance is given out to be 80 and volume of distribution is given out to be 40. What maintenance dose should be administered intravenously every 6 hours to eventually obtain the every steady state concentration of 4 mg per ml. Now if you talk about the formula of maintenance dose is clearance into steady state concentration. Now we know that the clearance is given is 80 ml per minute. Okay, 80 ml per minute, and the steady state concentration which is given is 4 mg per liter. Now the point is, it is given in liters, here it is given in ml. So what we have to do, we have to convert this ml into liters. Okay, we have to convert this ml into liters. So what we can do, we will divide it by 1000. So it will come out to be liters again. Okay. Now the point is, we will cut liters by liters, and it will come out to be 320 upon 1000 milligram per minute. Okay, milligram per minute, which will be equal to 0.32 milligram per minute. So this much is the maintenance dose of a drug that we must give in 1 minute. Let's convert it into 1 hour. To convert it into 1 hour, we will multiply it by 60. And to convert it into 6 hours, as the question is asking, we will multiply by the 6. Okay, so we will multiply by the 6. So the answer will come out to be 3.2 multiplied by 36. Okay, if you will multiply 3.2 by 36, it will come out to be 115.2 milligram every 6 hours. So this is the maintenance dose of a drug that we must give every 6 hours. Okay, so there is no role of volume of distribution out here. So in maintenance dose only depends upon clearance and initial concentration. It does not depend upon the volume of distribution that is given is useless. If you wish to give, let's come to the question 12. If you wish to give the aforementioned patient an intravenous loading dose. Now the question is asking about loading dose. Loading dose, to achieve the therapeutic plasma concentration of this, how much you should give? So loading dose you have to calculate. And you must remember VD into steady state concentration is equal to the loading dose. Now, here the loading dose given is 40 liters. And the steady state concentration you want to achieve is 4 milligram per liter. So, okay, 4 milligram per liter. So what should be the loading dose? The loading dose will come out to be 160 milligram. 160 milligram will be the loading dose. Now let's come to 13th question. The clearance and the VD of the drugs are this. Predict the half-life. So we know the half-life formula is 0.693 VD upon CL. You know the VD is 1.386 and the clearance, sorry, the VD which is given is 80 liters and the clearance is given out to be 1.386 liters per hour. So we can calculate the half-life in R. Okay, so if you'll calculate or solve this question, your answer will come out to be 40 hours. If you will solve this, all these equations, so the answer will come out to be 40 hours. If a patient with mild digitalis toxicity has a plasma concentration of this 4 nanogram per ml, so the plasma concentration is given. Renal function is normal and half-life of digoxin is given. Half-life is given 1.5 days. How long you should withhold the digoxin to reach the safer yet probably therapeutic level of 1 nanogram per ml? Now the point is, the concentration of digoxin is 4. And you want to see after how much time it will become 1. We know that the time required to make a drug half, 2, is known as half-life. And the half-life of digoxin is 1.5 days. And after next 1.5 days, it will become another half. It will come out to be 1 nanogram per ml. It will come out to be 1 nanogram per ml. So it will require how much days? It will require 3 days. So the answer for this question is C, 3 days. Okay. So the answer is 3 days. Let's come to 15. All other reasons for alteration of drug dosage in elderly except. Remember, with old age, the elderly renal function decreases. The answer is absolutely yes. They are lean and their body mass is less. The answer is absolutely yes. They have increased baroreceptor sensitivity. The answer is no. Rather, they have reduced baroreceptor sensitivity. That is why they are more prone to develop postural hypotension. Their body water is decreased. The answer is absolutely true. Or yes. So the incorrect statement is C. That is, they have increased baroreceptor sensitivity. No, it is rather reduced. So these are the various changes which occurs with old age. Now the pharmacokinetic change occurring in geriatric patient is decline in. Remember, all the capacity of the body will reduce. The major decline in renal geriatric function or old age patient is renal clearance. The power of a kidney to remove a drug gradually and it is proportionally reduced with old age. That is why you can see that in old age patient, their serum creatinine and serum urea level are always remain high as compared to a normal adult individual. Okay. The term physical half-life. Remember, the term physical half-life is given for radioactive materials. Okay. But in pharmacokinetic, we discuss about a half-life. In pharmacokinetic, with the half-life we discuss is known as elimination half-life. For the drugs, the half-life which we call them as elimination half-life. But there is one more kind of half-life known as radioactive half-life or radioactive delay. This is known as physical half-life. It is for radioactive isotopes. Okay, so try to remember. Now let's come to elimination after 3 half-life. Remember, if the drug is initially 100, after first half-life, 50% of the drug will be remaining in the blood, 50% will be eliminated. After second half-life, 25% will remain in the blood and total 75% of the drug will be eliminated. Among the third half-life, 12.5% and 87.5% of the drug will be eliminated out. Hence, the answer is 87.5%. After 3 half-life, 87.5% drug will be eliminated. The drug remaining in the body will be 12.5. Okay. Now, zero order kinetic occurs in following drugs with high dose. We have already discussed the answer was alcohol and theophylline. So try to remember the mnemonic WhatsApp, ATP. ATP is alcohol, theophylline and phenytoin. Now, which of the following is the most accurate method of calculating the drug dosage in children? It is always and always body surface area. And remember, body surface area is calculated by a formula known as Dubois formula. It is calculated by a formula, Dubois formula. Okay. Now, let's talk about routes of drug administration. Now, if you talk about routes of drug administration, The first question is asking that true regarding intramuscular route is, it is often faster and more complete than with oral. The answer is absolutely true. Just apply the common sense. Large volumes may be given if the drug is not too irritating. Absolutely true. Drugs like heparin should not be given. Remember, anticoagulant drugs are absolutely contraindicated by intramuscular injection. True, because it can lead to hematoma formation. So anticoagulant drugs are never given, like heparin. Intramuscularly, it leads to hematoma formation. Now, all of the following can be administered by transdermal route except. The answer is, for this question, is C, vasopressin. Okay, C, vasopressin. So I'll just show you the list of the drugs which are given by transdermal routes. So just go by this route, this list. So these are the various drugs which are given by transdermal routes. Nicotine for smoking cessation, naltrexone for opioid de-addiction, nitroglycerin, rotigotin for Parkinson's disease, estrogen for as a hormonal replacement therapy, etc., etc. Rivastigmin for Alzheimer's, fentanyl as an opioid analgesic, scopolamine, diphenhydramine for motion sickness and clonidine for hypertension. Okay. So these are the drugs. Which of the following drugs can be administered by intranasal route? The answer for this question is 2, oxytocin. Oxytocin is the best answer. But nowadays we also have intranasal insulin also. So it's an old question. Your answer is oxytocin. But nowadays we also have insulin as well. Intranasal insulin or inhalational insulin. Okay. Now, true statement about route of drug administration is 80% bioavailability is by IV injection. It is absolutely false. Remember, bioavailability of intravenous drug is absolutely 100%. Okay. Intramuscular administration needs sterile technique. The answer is absolutely true. Otherwise, it will lead to pus or abscess or infection into the muscle. It should always be sterile technique. Intradermal injection produces local tissue necrosis and irritation. The answer is absolutely true. That is why after BCG vaccine, there is a formation of scar due to local tissue necrosis. Now, inhalation produces delayed systemic absorption. The answer is false. It will rather produce rapid absorption because lungs, it contains the most amount of blood supply among all organs. So the answer for this question, number fourth, are two. Two options are there, intramuscular, true, and intradermal produces local tissue necrosis. So B and C are the correct options. The followings are given by intradermally except. Now remember, intradermally we most commonly do allergenic testing. Allergenic testing of a drug and BCG vaccine is done through allergenic, through intradermal route. So if you talk about test dose of a drug for allergic testing, the answer is absolutely true. BCG vaccine, true. Montu test, which is a type of immunity test for tuberculosis, again true. So the incorrect answer is insulin. Insulin is not given intradermally. Okay, so this is all about pharmacokinetics.